So first of all, thank you for kind of having me here. From what I've seen, Malta is a very, very beautiful place and you're all very lucky. Secondly, here's something for any of you who go into the science, right? Never be one of the speakers towards the end, right? Because all of your colleagues who either can't or refuse to answer questions will always pass the buck down the line, right? And I wish I'd spoken to these people before I written my talk, because my talk is nothing like what they're expecting my talk to be, right? So in the time-honored tradition of being a scientist, if you have any questions, Chris will answer them all tomorrow as last speaker. Okay, so the title of my talk is Building and Detecting Black Holes, right? So I'll basically cover compact objects, black holes, and things called gravitational waves. Now, I'll basically kind of preface this talk with basically saying there's a lot of confusing ideas ahead, okay? And if you get to the end of the talk and you're still confused, it doesn't mean that you haven't understood the material, it just means it's confusing, okay? So the first thing I'll do is I'll basically talk about compact objects. Now, I basically think that these PDFs and stuff will be available online afterwards. So at the start of each section, I've just put a little kind of little list here of the main topics covered so that you can jump from section to section with the PDFs afterwards. So as we saw yesterday, stars basically form from contractions of gas in molecular clouds of hydrogen, right? When a lump of gas or material gets larger than something called the Jeans length, then it begins to contract under its own gravitational pull. So you basically get these huge clumps. I'm like, these clumps here are bigger than the solar system. And they will eventually form stars and possibly even planets, depending on the amount of kind of heavy materials in the dust cloud. So basically what happens is my dust cloud contracts, and at a certain point, it becomes hot enough in the center that I start getting thermonuclear fusion. So basically, there's a huge thermonuclear explosion right at the center, which starts fusing hydrogen together. And this is good, because this is the only way that stars can actually stay upright as stars, because everything in the universe has something called gravity pulling it towards the center of a potential, okay? And basically, for a star to stay upwards, or to basically resist against gravity, it needs something as powerful as thermonuclear fusion, which basically exerts an outward radiation pressure. So basically, as long as there's enough fuel in the star and it can continue to basically start producing stuff with thermonuclear fusion, it'll resist the pull of gravity. So let's take an example of a star like our own sun, okay? It starts off mostly hydrogen in the outside, but basically once the thermonuclear fusion starts, we know that anything that burns produces ash. And basically the ash of hydrogen is helium. So it's hottest at the center, and basically as the star starts to burn, we get the formation of a helium core right in the center of the star. Now, the way it is, and with the mass it is, our star is not big enough to actually start burning helium. So you get this weird situation where you get a buildup of helium ash in the center, and it's not burning. It's just kind of like creating more and more ash. What happens then is it starts to get heavy, and it begins to contract under its own gravity, which means all the outer layers of hydrogen now start to fall in and collapse. But basically, as they fall in, they get compressed. And as they get compressed, they start to heat up. And once again, you get thermonuclear fusion starting in a thin shell around the core. This is producing more and more helium, so it means the core is getting heavier and the star starts to get more and more unstable. So when that happens, stars get puffy. And basically the outer layers start to expand until we're at a point whereby the outer layers are basically bigger than the orbit of Mercury. So now if Mercury has survived this process, it's actually orbiting inside the surface of the sun. So as things get bigger and hotter, then the temperature at the center of the star reaches about 10 to the 8 Kelvin. And at this point, it is hot enough and dense enough that you can start burning helium through thermonuclear fusion. And you get the formation of elements like carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, But once again, we need to reach a natural limit. Because of the size, it's not big enough to burn carbon. So you get a solid carbon core starting to form at the center of the star. This collapses because it's really, really heavy. It collapses under its own weight. And once again, you get this kind of oscillation starting to happen where the outer layers become so puffy now that the star evolves into something called a red giant. And at this point, the outer layers of the star are actually kind of outside of Earth's orbit. So at this point, all the inner planets have been completely vaporized. And this is something that's going to happen in roughly about 5 billion years' time. The sun is currently about halfway through its life cycle. So at this point, the star is now becoming unstable because you're getting kind of flashes of thermonuclear fusion. So it's kind of pushing outwards, then there's not enough fuel to burn, so it starts to collapse back inwards. And basically, you start shaking the entire star until at a certain point, the outer layers become so unstable that they get ejected completely. And this leads to some very, very nice pictures. And these are what we call planetary nebula. Each one of these pictures here is a star roughly the same size as our own sun at the end of its life cycle. Now, the important thing with these objects is that right at the center, there's an associated bright point. And this is basically the leftover carbon core, or what we call a white dwarf star. And a white dwarf is roughly about 0.6 of a solar mass, and a solar mass is about 10 to the 30 kilograms. The thing has shrunk to roughly about the same size as the Earth, so it has a radius of about 6,500 kilometers. However, the density is now kind of more than 10,000 times the density of the original star, and it now has a surface temperature about 10 times hotter than the sun, so a surface temperature of about 10 to the 4 Kelvin. And the central temperature is basically roughly about the same temperature as the center of a star, 10 to the 7 Kelvin. But there's still this ongoing battle against gravity, right? So basically what happens is the white dwarf still needs to stay stable. It has to try and kind of counteract this inward pull that gravity has. And the only way it can do that is by using quantum mechanics. So at this point, the atoms inside the white dwarf now exist in the form of a plasma. And as usual, gravity is trying to pull everything towards the center of the potential, so right towards the center of the white dwarf. If we're lucky enough and you have something like a white dwarf, then it basically counteracts the force of gravity by using something from quantum mechanics called the Pauli exclusion principle. And basically what this says is that if I want to build atoms, and if I want to build heavier and heavier atoms, as soon as I populate the energy levels, so that here's my nucleus, I put in an electron. There's room left for one extra electron, but I can't put an electron with the same spin into the same energy level. This is the exclusion principle. The only way that I can basically do things is I can put an electron with an opposite spin into the energy level. So basically, I have all these electrons floating around. Right, and imagine of the first 10,000 electrons that pass by, 99.99% of them all have the same spin as the electron that's already there. This is basically exerting a pressure called degenerate pressure, and the atom is waiting for this opposite spin electron to just happen along before it can sit into the energy level. So this basically gives you an outward pressure which resists against gravity. Now, degenerate matter is kind of special because for a normal gas, the pressure is proportional to the temperature. The higher the temperature, the higher the pressure of the gas. But for degenerate matter, the pressure is proportional to the density of particles. So the kind of more dense the number of particles, the greater the pressure. Temperature doesn't come into it. And there's a nice relation between the size and the mass of a white dwarf. It goes like this, and in the early 1900s, a very, very talented Indian physicist called Chandrasekhar measured or derived the maximum mass that a white dwarf can have. Now, this is considered to be one of the most beautiful results in all of physics, because instead of having a whole bunch of constants and kind of numerical factors and stuff, the Chandrasekhar mass is basically proportional to the fundamental constants of the universe. So Planck's constant, or Planck's constant is over 2 pi, the speed of light, and Newton's gravitational constant. And this basically gives you a mass of 1.4 times the mass of the sun. So as long as the object is less than 1.4 times the mass of the sun, it can exist as a white dwarf. But not all our stars are the same size as the sun. Some of them are much, much bigger. And when you go back to the early universe, you have stars that were maybe hundreds or thousands of solar masses in size. Now we have a completely different process, because instead of just burning from hydrogen through to, say, carbon or oxygen, we can now basically build the entire periodic table all the way up to iron. Iron kind of has a very, very special point on the periodic table, because you can build lighter particles to get to iron. But when you get to iron, you have to put in an external process in order to build heavier particles. So iron is a natural stopping point in the periodic table for period building. So in this case, we know already that the star is so massive that electron degeneracy pressure is not going to resist against gravity. So there's another form of degeneracy pressure called neutron degeneracy pressure. And basically what happens here is, here's my nucleus composed of, let's say it's a helium nucleus, composed of two protons and two neutrons. And basically I have my electrons, which are basically orbiting quite happily outside the nucleus. Gravity pulls the electrons inside the nucleus, where they basically combine with the protons, and I now basically get four neutrons with the emission of particles called neutrinos. When this happens, I'm taking up less space, because instead of now having six particles, I only have four. And to show you how remarkable this is, somebody once gave the analogy that if I pretend that a football stadium is the atom, and all my electrons sit in the very, very, very outside of the actual stadium, then my nucleus would be represented by a fly sat in the center of the football pitch. That's how small the nucleus is compared to the atom as a whole. So gravity has to basically drag those electrons from way out right into the center of the nucleus, where they can then combine with the protons. So this results in something called a supernova. And these are actually quite remarkable. We don't fully understand the mechanisms. As computing increases, we basically can run better and better simulations, so we get a better idea of what's going on. But essentially what happens is the core of iron basically is heavier than the Chandrasekhar mass. So it's greater than 1.4 solar masses. It then begins to collapse because gravity is pulling the electrons inside the nuclei. All the electrons are basically forming or combining with the protons to form neutrons, and we get a massive shrinking of the nucleus, or of the core of the star, which happens roughly at the speed of light. So the outer layers are still just gas, right? So because of the fact that the core contracts so quickly, it leaves a massive gap between the edge of the core and the inner layers of the gas. So once the signal has basically propagated outwards that the core has shrunk, then gravity starts to pull all of the outer layers inwards. And this basically happens at a speed of roughly 70,000 kilometers per second. So imagine a solid neutron core, and basically you have all this gas falling inwards at 70,000 kilometers per second. So basically the gas hits the core and bounces outwards. But you also get this huge emission of neutrinos, which also help lift the outer layers outwards. And basically, if you're lucky enough for a particular type of supernova, you get a core left behind, and we basically see something like this, where all of a sudden, those outer layers that have been lifted off the core shine brighter than the totality of the galaxy itself. And again, this gives us some really, really nice pictures. And the interesting thing is, and this is why kind of simulations of supernova is so difficult. If you remember the images of planetary nebula, they all looked quite similar, okay? They were all quite spherical with a point at the center. You can see that supernova are very, very rarely the same, okay? They all kind of have different asymmetries in the explosion due to different processes. Possibly there's heavier or different concentrations of heavier elements, and this basically affects the way a star explodes. So no two supernova are the same. So what's left behind? Well, it's basically what we call a neutron star. And depending on the equation of state, it will have a mass somewhere between about 1.3 and 2 solar masses. I say the depending on the equation of state, because we cannot recreate the interior of a neutron star in a laboratory, right? No matter how dense we make things, it's just beyond our physical capabilities. The amazing thing now is that the radius of a neutron star is about 12 kilometers across. So you've basically packed something more massive than the sun itself into a spherical ball roughly about the size of a big city. What's that? Okay. So basically the densities, we're now up to 10 to the 17 kilograms per cubic meter. And the temperature, the surface temperature of the neutron star is roughly 100 million Kelvin. The fascinating thing about these is the rotation period, right? These things, 12 or 24 kilometers across, weighing more than the sun actually does, are actually spinning on their own axis somewhere between a millisecond, once every millisecond, and once every 30 seconds. Now, I've tried to visualize what that would look like, and it shows the limit of human imagination because it's impossible to visualize. You cannot visualize something bigger than a city or the size of an island rotating that quickly. Or if you can, please let me know how you did it. The other thing is that the surface gravity is now about 10 to the 11 times the surface gravity on Earth, right? So it basically means that if I want to launch a rocket or something off the surface of a neutron star, if I'm doing that on Earth, the escape velocity is about 11 kilometers a second. That'll get me into space. If I want to do the same thing off a neutron star, I have to launch the rocket at about a third the speed of light. So like I said, we don't really know what kind of neutron stars or what the interior looks like because it's completely out of our realm of experience. But a pretty good guess is that there's some kind of a thin atmosphere, maybe a couple of tens or hundreds of meters thick. Then we expect there to be some kind of an iron-iron lattice, which basically gives it its rigid structure. We then think that there may be some kind of a nuclear liquid soup or something like that on the inside. And then the inner core, we just don't know. Some people have hypothesized that at the densities and temperatures at the center of a neutron star, that basically atoms, things like protons and neutrons, actually break up into their constituent quarks. And we have a free-floating quark matter, right? But again, this is just all hypothesis. We're kind of lucky though, because these things are quite easy to detect. When you have the explosion, a certain amount of matter stays in and around the neutron star. And basically, because of the rotation of the neutron star, it maybe forms a disk, and then it forms a jet of emission, which we can detect in radio or kind of other particles. And in fact, the first time that this was actually detected was by a British female astronomer called Jocelyn Bell, who had built quite a rudimentary radio telescope in Cambridge. And one day she got this constant blip detection, equally spaced blip. And for a little while, they titled this object an LGM, which stood for Little Green Men, because their immediate thought was this was too regular a signal to be from a natural source. And the thought was that maybe it was some kind of distant civilization trying to contact us here on Earth. But over the next few months, they found a whole bunch of other ones. And the term pulsar was coined, and we now know that it's a rapidly spinning neutron star that's basically emitting particles through a beam. So if everything is kind of bigger than 3 solar masses, then electron degeneracy pressure doesn't work. Neutron degeneracy pressure doesn't work, and basically gravity starts to pull everything in towards the center. And if you have that much mass in a sphere about 18 kilometers across, the only option left is what we call a black hole. Now, black holes are, as I put it down here, simultaneously the simplest and the most complex objects in the universe. So before we move on to black holes, because there's been quite a lot of material here, does anybody have any questions about our quick capsule review of stellar evolution? Or can I move on to black holes? Okay, looks like I can move on. So to understand black holes, you need a brief history of gravity. And after that, I have to give you a crash course in general relativity, which is, of course, why you're all here, right? So for a brief history of gravity, we have to go back to Aristotle. Aristotle basically thought that objects had a nature to do things. So he basically looked around and saw there was heavy elements, such as rocks and the earth and stuff like that, and that basically if you dropped one of them, it moved downwards. Whereas things like fire and air always seem to move upwards. So he came to the conclusion that heavy objects, due to their nature, are always trying to fall to the center of the universe, whereas light objects, due to their nature, are always trying to reach towards the heavens. And that was his basically reason for why certain things do what they do. And this was all good until Galileo came along. Galileo hypothesized that basically, if you drop two objects, they all accelerate equally when falling. So let me ditch the microphone for a second. So I have a tennis ball and I have a piece of paper, right? If I drop them, which one is going to hit the ground first? The tennis ball. Why? Okay, so you know, we do that and basically you can see that everything works, right? But this is much, what's that? So Aristotle was right, okay? Heavier objects fall faster than light objects, because I know this is heavier than this, right? So let me kind of ball this up as much as I can. And now if I conduct the same experiment, I've neglected air resistance, and basically the light piece of paper falls in this room imperceivably as fast as the tennis ball. So Galileo was correct, and there's actually kind of, there's a very, very nice video that you can find on YouTube of the Apollo astronauts carrying out this experiment on the moon, where they dropped a hammer and a feather on the moon and both of them fell to the ground at the same time. So this was the vindication that Galileo was absolutely correct in his hypothesis.
Can I mention here that in our lab there's a group that's trying to do this with antimatter, dropping anti-atoms to see if they fall.
Oh, okay. Okay. So then after Galileo, we had to wait a couple of years for Newton to come along. And basically, Newton's zeroth law is never sit under a tree that's going to potentially drop something without wearing some kind of a helmet. Okay. And then he also, in his spare time, came up with something called the law of universal gravitation. And basically what Newton concluded was that if I have two objects, there's some kind of force between them that basically drags the two objects towards each other. And this force is proportional to 1/ the distance. And then he worked out that this force had some kind of constant of proportionality, which we now know is Newton's constant. But here's where things get a little bit tricky. He also kind of introduced the concept of absolute time and absolute space. So for people like Newton and Galileo and all the astronomers that came before them, from their youngest ages as a child, if they looked towards the sky, they would see the constellations. And then they get to middle age and they look towards the sky and they see exactly the same constellations. The constellations haven't moved. And then they get to old age and once again, the constellations haven't moved. So they basically came to the conclusion that there was some kind of fixed reference frame in the universe, that these kind of objects that were far away in the universe just didn't move at all, and that we somehow rotated with respect to them. And again, in a time when there was a lot of kind of metaphysical questions being asked, people were always kind of asking, where do we come from? Where does the universe come from? So people had this concept of an absolute time, that there's some mystical arrow of time that goes off into the infinite future that has come from the infinite past, and that basically when you ask a question like, what happened before the Big Bang, that it makes sense. And what I hope to show you through this talk is that unfortunately, not all questions that can be posed in a grammatically correct manner make sense. And I hope to show you that there is no sense to the question of what happened before the Big Bang. Okay? So, I'm Newton, and I think that time is universal. I think that space is universal. I think that there basically exists a singular universal frame of reference. Now, I look at the world around me, and the ancient Greeks had basically worked out that sound was basically waves traveling through matter in the that we call air, right? And it was basically a disturbance of these particles and could be interpreted as a wave. I look out at the sea and I basically kind of see the waves on top of the surface. And I know then that if sound waves are basically waves in matter and water waves are waves in water and I see light, then my logical conclusion is that they must be waves in some medium. So we basically had something created or kind of postulated called ether. And basically the ether was this kind of universal reference frame. It was the material that light was a wave of. And people had basically tried to measure the ether. So a bunch of guys called Michelson and Morley decided that they would basically look at measuring the ether. And their kind of experiment was set up with the fact that if the Earth is actually moving through the ether, and you look at the speed of light, as you move in the direction of flow of the ether, then the speed of light will be slightly different to when you're basically moving against the flow of the ether. And if they could basically measure the speed of light at two different times of the year or multiple times in the year, that they would actually detect this ether flow or this ether wind that we were supposed to live in. And Michelson was kind of pretty confident about being able to do this because he'd already very, very successfully measured the speed of light in 1897 using a light interferometer. And again, he was working on the hypothesis that, you know, sound is speed of sound is relative to air, so the speed of light must be relative to the ether. And they made the measurement of light as the Earth went around the sun, and surprise, surprise, they found no evidence of an ether. And in fact, modern day experiments have basically shown that if you conduct the same experiment and you measure the speed of light using a laser at different points through the year, that the rate or the change in the speed of light is less than 1 part in 10 to the minus 17. And this is for something that moves at 10 to the 8 meters per second. Okay, so that's a phenomenally accurate measurement. So this actually kind of then raised a problem because Maxwell had developed the equations of electromagnetism and Newton had kind of developed the laws of motion. And the two of them were incompatible with each other. If you wanted to roll something down a slope or you wanted to work out the force to get something moving, then Newton's laws work perfectly well. If you wanted to work out the speed of light in an interferometer or the electromagnetic charge or potential of something, Maxwell's equations worked really, really well. But try to put the two of them together and you couldn't get kind of sensible answers. So this is where Einstein came up with the special theory of relativity. As Michelson-Morley had pretty much shown there was no ether, then Einstein completely ditched the idea of an ether, and with that went the idea of an absolute reference frame. So believe it or not, special relativity is based on the principle of relativity. And to go to the principle of relativity, we now have to go backwards in time to Galileo. Now, he would have been surprised to see a bullet train going past, but we all know that there were bullet trains in the time of Galileo. But imagine we have Galileo standing in the middle of a field. And he hears this noise and he looks to the left and he sees this bullet train approaching, going past him and off into the distance at three separate points in time, traveling at a constant velocity v. That's all fine because as far as he's concerned, yeah, moving things move very, very quickly at a constant speed. But if you now go to the position of the person actually driving the train, as far as he's concerned, he sat in his seat everything is completely normal. He's at rest with respect to the train, and he basically sees Galileo standing in the field, and at point he knows the person's off in the distance. At a certain point he's alongside, and at point T2 he's way behind. And this basically showed, even back in terms of Galileo, that observations are completely relative. Depends on whether you're at rest or whether you perceive yourself to be at rest. So Einstein postulated that any reference frame, so either the person in the train or the person kind of standing on the ground, anybody moving with a uniform velocity will observe the same laws of physics. And this makes sense because you always want to be able to repeat an experiment, and you don't want to have to be in an absolute stationary reference frame to do it. And the other postulate was that the speed of light in a vacuum is always a constant. Now, we live in a Newtonian world. Our experiences are completely Newtonian, okay? So I can basically say that if I kind of wanted to put a Cartesian coordinate system around myself, that I'm kind of at 0, 0, 0, and my velocity is 0. But my velocity is 0 with respect to this room. It's kind of 0 with respect to the city we're in. But we know that Malta is sitting on a tectonic plate, and that tectonic plate is moving. So I'm not at rest with respect to that. We also know that the Earth is moving around the Sun at about 30 kilometers a second. So am I at rest with respect to that? And if I basically make that my reference frame, then afterwards, the Sun is going around the center of the Milky Way, and the galaxy is going around the local group. And, you know, as we saw yesterday, we could be in some filament, some cluster of galaxies. So where do I measure my reference frame? If I say that I'm moving, or if I say that I'm rest, with respect to what? And this was where the problem came in that Einstein was trying to solve. Fortunately, it leads to a little bit of weirdness. And here's where things start to get non-Newtonian. And this is where all our common sense kind of ideas start to go out the window. So the first is a concept called time dilation. So imagine, off in the future, I have my own spaceship, and I have a very, very accurate clock. And my clock basically works by bouncing photons between two perfectly polished mirrors. Now, I separate them at about 150,000 kilometers from each other, which means that the total round time for one photon to basically bounce and come back is a second, right? And this is so accurate that my clock only works every time the photon hits the upper mirror. So my clock is advancing at 1 second every second. How does this look like to somebody who's basically, say, on Earth, who's looking at me with some super powerful telescope? What he basically sees is the photon gets emitted, I'm moving, the mirrors are moving, so basically he thinks that the photon has traveled a lot further than 150,000 kilometers, and then when it bounces off the bottom mirror, it has to travel much, much further again. And he basically thinks that this whole thing took a quantity delta T prime to actually happen. And this is where time dilation comes in. So this delta T prime, so the amount of time it took for the observer to think it happened, and the amount of time it took for me to think it happened, is related by this factor here, gamma, which is 1 over the square root of 1 minus v squared over c squared. So let's put in some numbers. Imagine I'm traveling at 99.5% the speed of light. Again, this is 150,000 kilometers. So v squared over c squared is 0.995, which gives me a gamma of 14. What this basically says is that the person who's stationary, who's looking at me through a telescope, sees my clocks and my time and everything that I'm doing slow down by a factor of 14. So that's the first piece of weirdness. As I move faster, a stationary observer concludes that my time has slowed down. But for me, everything is the same as it always is. When I look at my watch, it's still advancing at 1 second every second. So before I leave, my engineers, who I have complete confidence in, give me a user manual for my ship. And my user manual tells me that my ship is 100 meters long. So it's 100 meters long, and everything's normal, and I'm quite happy sat inside it. But again, what does somebody on the outside see? And this basically depends on how fast I'm actually going. Because now we have something called length contraction, where the length that's observed is the original length divided by this gamma factor. So if I'm going at a tenth of the speed of light, it's roughly 100 meters, so they really see no difference in the length of my ship. But as I approach the speed of light, the perceived length of my ship gets thinner and thinner and thinner. Now, you can basically have conversations in the world with people who have different beliefs. And people are very, very protective of their beliefs. The worst audience that I've ever explained this to was at a conference on science and science fiction. And there was a bunch of people who were obviously huge fans of Star Trek The Next Generation. I don't know how many of you have seen it. Now, every time the Enterprise jumps to warp speed, the front of the ship takes off and the whole thing elongates. And then when it comes to a stop, it basically recontracts, right? So I basically pointed out to this audience that the engines are at the back of the ship. The engines start moving first. It takes time, the speed of light, for the front of the ship to find out that the back of the ship has already started moving, and that in fact, the entire thing should contract when it goes to warp speed and should elongate when it arrives at the other side. And I counted 17 people who got up and left the room. Because I had offended Star Trek The Next Generation. Okay, so be careful who you kind of offend in this life. So again, let's put in some numbers. So I'm back at kind of 99.5% speed of light. My ship, as far as I see it, is about 100 meters long, but my observer measures my ship at about 7 meters. But the contraction is only in the direction of propagation, okay? The height and the width stays exactly the same. So this is one of the weirder things. So it's not a global contraction. So imagine now my observer is basically watching my ship go past. Basically what he sees is he basically sees something that's quite big, but immensely kind of squished from one end to the other, go past at 99.5%, or in this case, 99.99% of the speed of light. What does my pilot see? My pilot sees an incredibly thin, slightly anorexic looking man who's of normal height, basically go past in the opposite direction at the same speed. So, here's my next observation, that things moving fast relative to me look compressed, and I look compressed to them, but in my frame of reference, everything is still good, right? My ship is still 100 meters long. So one of the next weird things is what's called the relativity of simultaneity, right? So I have somebody who's basically stood in the field, who likes watching trains. He knows that the brand new train is going to go past as opposed to approach the speed of light. And just as it would have it, there's also a thunderstorm. And these two trees get struck by lightning at exactly the same time. So he sees the two flashes of light. So the photons traveling from the trees to him arrive at the same time. So if you asked him, you know, did you see the thunderstorm? You go, yeah, yeah, and those two trees got struck at the same time. The person on the train who's moving at 4/5 the speed of light is now moving at 4/5 the speed of light in this direction, which means that he's going to encounter the photons coming from this lightning strike first. The photons from this lightning strike are going to take a while to catch up with him because they're going at speed of light. He's going at 4/5 the speed of light. And if you ask him afterwards, he's going to say, yeah, I was really lucky because, you know, it hit me before I got there. But then later on, there was another lightning strike behind me. So this is the next observation. Events occur at different times depending on whether I'm stationary or moving. Now, again, coming back to our Newtonian world, one of the things that we're always used to asking is, when did something happen? What relativity says is it happened at different times depending on your frame of reference. So very, very quick little anecdote, which shows you kind of why eyewitness testimony should never be kind of believed. There was a study conducted in the US whereby a whole bunch of people were sat in front of a screen, and they were basically told that there was going to be a bunch of couples in the screen who were going to throw basketballs back and forth between each other. And the goal was to basically work out how many times the basketballs had moved between people. So they got to the end of the experiment, people gave in their answers, and the person running the experiment said, right, who saw the gorilla? And everybody's looking at him blank-faced in the audience. And when they reran the clip, in the middle of all this happening, a guy in a gorilla suit walks out into the center of everybody, beats his chest with his hands, and calmly strolls off the other side. And only something like 2% of the people in the audience saw the gorilla, which basically kind of informs you that when you're looking at something, everybody is looking at something different, and you can very, very easily miss stuff, which is why we don't take eyewitness testimony anymore. So Einstein decided, right, if there's no reference frames that are universal, if there's no time that's universal, then he created, or he postulated the idea of something called space-time. So now you have a four-dimensional construct which allows you to basically locate a point, but not just a point in space or a point in time, but in this global construct of space-time. And in this construct, so if I'm at this point A, then if I have a light, right, then all my light beams travel outwards at a 45-degree angle. If some things are coming at me from the past, so if I'm looking at a distant quasar or something like that, they're coming from the past, but they're coming at a 45-degree angle. And basically, because I can't travel faster than the speed of light, my kind of motion is limited to inside the cone here. Now, you can basically write down an equation that allows you to go outside the cone, and that's what we call time travel. And time travel is not allowed for anything other than philosophical reasons, because somebody once asked the question, if time travel was happening or was kind of possible, could I go back in time and kill my parents before they had me? And if I did that, then I wouldn't have been born to go back in time to kill. And people started getting nosebleeds and headaches, so it was decided that time travel was not allowed. So Einstein had basically successfully reconciled Newton's laws of motion and Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism. But now he needed something that would reconcile Newtonian gravity and special relativity. And this is where general relativity comes in. So basically, he had what is called a thought experiment. And he basically said that if I'm in a container with no doors or windows or no kind of influence from the outside world, that basically, if I'm in the middle of space, I'm going to float freely inside this container. If I'm some unlucky sod who's basically inside a lift in the center of a building and the cables have snapped and the lift is now in free fall, I'm also going to float. So I can't actually tell the difference between floating freely in space and floating freely in free fall in a gravitational field, because in both situations, the person experiences weightlessness. This is how we train astronauts, right? So we basically take them up on a plane and we put the plane into as close to free fall as we can. And for a certain amount of time, they're in zero gravity. So they just float around. So his second kind of thought experiment was that I'm once again in a container with no doors and windows. I know I'm standing in a gravitational field, or I think I'm standing in a gravitational field. I know what the value of g is. I know it's 9.8 meters per second squared. And I know that if I drop an apple or any other object, it's basically going to fall to the floor. What he also kind of hypothesized was that if I now take that container and I put the person in space, and I'm accelerating forward at exactly 9.8 meters per second, if I drop the ball or the apple or whatever, it's going to float freely in space. But the base of the container is accelerating upwards at 9.8 meters per second. From my point of view, it's falling. Okay? So it's impossible to tell if you're sitting in the middle of a gravitational field or you're accelerating in space with the same acceleration. And a third thought experiment to think about this was, so I'm out in the middle of space. I have some kind of laser emitter or something that emits a pulse, and I've got some kind of sensor over here. So I'm basically standing, I'm watching the pulses go across from one side to the other. From my point of view, everything is going in a straight line. So my pulses are repetitive and they're in a straight line. If I go to my freely falling point of view, inside my container, my pulses are still going in a straight line, okay? But how does this look to somebody outside? Somebody outside basically sees over the kind of pulse emission time, they see the pulse following a curved path. Now, this observer knows they're in a gravitational field because they're standing on the ground. They know that they're kind of like G is kind of pulling them down. They can feel their weight, so they know they're not kind of floating around in space. And the observer concludes that gravity bends light. So this led to the theory of general relativity. And basically, if an observer observes that gravity bends light, but we know that light tries to travel on the straightest line possible, both of these things can only be true if the space-time that the light has trajected is actually curved. So this was basically the thing that kind of changed everything. Einstein concluded that gravity is not a force, it's a manifestation of curved space-time. And basically, light does try to travel on the shortest kind of path possible. And if that space-time is curved, then it travels on something called a geodesic, which is the shortest path between two points in a curved space. And also because of time dilation, length contraction, everything else, that basically, if you have a clock in a gravitational field, it'll tick slower than a clock in space. And we've tested this with atomic clocks on planes, and this is why GPS works, right? Because when GPS was first kind of put up there, you basically use the radio equivalent of triangulation. You have a bunch of satellites, you know what the time is on a clock on each satellite. You basically measure the distance to the position on Earth. You use overlapping circles, and then you can basically find where the person is. However, because of Einstein's prediction that clocks in a gravitational field tick slower, when these corrections were put in, that's then when we knew we could actually make GPS works. So if you hadn't corrected for special and general relativity, your GPS would basically be telling you turn left and you're looking at the sea going, yeah, but I don't want to drive over the sea, right? Because it can't work out where the hell you are. So general relativity basically says that now I have a four-dimensional construct called space-time. The gravitational field or gravitational force is nothing more than the curvature of space-time, and basically the more massive an object, the higher the curvature. So that's pretty good, right? What else comes in here is that we also know that E equals mc squared, so we know that energy is proportional to mass. So not only does mass curve space-time, but energy curves space-time. And we also know that momentum is proportional to mass, so it means something traveling with a certain momentum, especially if the momentum is high, can curve space-time. So, but is it true, right? That's the thing that everybody wants to know. And from the time of Newton, if you basically looked at a star at, say, in the month of January, right, and the star is basically here, the sun is behind you, you measured a certain position in the sky. But if you try doing it in July with the sun in front of you, you kind of very, very quickly realize that the star isn't where you measured it in January. And basically, Newton concluded that the gravitational force of the sun was somehow pulling the photons towards the sun. We now know, but he couldn't basically, even kind of using Newtonian mechanics, he could only come up with about half of the deflection that we actually see. But now we know from general relativity that the light is actually following the shortest path between two points, and it's following the curvature of space-time. And we now have a perfect agreement with Einstein's theory of general relativity. The second thing that Newton couldn't explain was that we know that the planets travel around the sun in an ellipse. But we noticed that Mercury, which is the closest planet to the sun, that its closest point of passage seemed to be shifting. And instead of just having a standard ellipse, the thing was basically tracing out a Rosetta pattern. This is once again explained perfectly by general relativity. And probably the greatest test of general relativity was the Cassini probe. one of the experiments was to basically send radio waves from the other side of the sun towards the Earth. And we knew now from general relativity what the delay should be if you take GR into account, and we basically have a perfect agreement. So finally, the bit you're all waiting for, black holes. So the next slide is probably the most profoundest slide that you'll see. And it basically says that, first off, black holes are black. Sorry. Because it's basically moving in a curved space-time. And because it's an ellipse, there's a slight kind of kick every time it goes to the center point, right? Which basically means that its outward trajectory is slightly different every time. So it basically processes over a period of time. Okay. Yeah, and this is something that you can see with anything. If you have a sheet of rubber and you put a heavy mass in the center so that the rubber gets deformed, and you push a smaller object in on an elliptical orbit, you'll actually see a slight precession as it moves its way around before it eventually falls to the center. Yes, but they still have to follow the curvature of space, right? Because everything follows the curvature of space, right? Because now, instead of having... So we know that a photon is an oscillation in the electromagnetic field, right? If space is flat, then the electromagnetic field is flat because it's lying on top of a flat surface. So it means that if you send a photon off in a certain direction, it'll basically continue in a straight line between points A and B, right? But if you now put something which is deformable on top of a deformed surface, then the electromagnetic field also becomes deformed. So the photon basically has to kind of find its own path from point A to B, and it basically moves in a curved trajectory. Ah, but you're confusing two different things. The space-time diagram is a mathematical construct, right? And it's just it's a way that that people who do relativity work out the trajectory of a particle mathematically, right? It's a visual representation of a mathematical construct. This is more of a spatial, everyday representation. So you can see here that if you have a certain amount of curvature, the grid lines get deformed. The electromagnetic field sitting on top of that grid also gets deformed, so the photon is just kind of going in the straightest line possible. So black holes are black, which is why they're very, very difficult to detect, because space is also black, and when you're looking for something black in a black background, it's difficult. So like I said, these are the simplest and most complex things in the universe. They're the simplest because they're composed of two things, a singularity and something called an event horizon. And like I said before, black holes deform space-time. So you get kind of curvature of light, but if the light particle is traveling in towards the black hole, it gets trapped inside the funnel, and basically the only way to go is downwards. So what is the event horizon? The event horizon is the point in space-time where, just to stand still, you need to be traveling at the speed of light. It's kind of a point of no return. So if you have some kind of spacecraft that's possible at going the speed of light, once you've crossed the event horizon, you still can't get back out. So this is also known as the Schwarzschild radius, after Carl Schwarzschild, who basically kind of worked this out from the principles of general relativity. But here's an exercise that you can try this afternoon. If I start off, because he was really the second person to derive this. Before you had general relativity, if you basically start off with conservation of energy in classical mechanics, so you basically equate the kinetic energy equal to the potential energy, and you solve for R and let the velocity equal to the speed of light, you get the exact same answer. And this was basically derived about a century before Schwarzschild. And it basically shows that any object can be kind of compressed into a space small enough that not even light can escape. What is physically possible afterwards is another question. So for the sun, if we were to squash it down into a black hole, we'd need to squash all of the mass of the sun into something which is about 6 kilometers across, right? But there's no physical process that can do that because the sun isn't massive enough and we know it's going to finish off as a white dwarf anyway. So here's an artist's impression of an accretion disk of gas around a black hole, right? And basically what happens with an accretion disk is if I have a particle that's moving in space-time, as it gets closer and closer to the black hole, it gets accelerated. It also has friction with the other particles, so it starts to get hotter. So it gets red hot, gets orange hot, comes back in here, it's yellow, and then at a certain point, it's white hot, right? Now you're thinking, as it goes in, it's going to get hotter and hotter. But what we actually kind of observe is that it seems to be cooling off again until a certain point we can't see it. This is because we know it's getting hotter because it's emitting radiation. But as it gets closer to the black hole, the radiation has to work harder to get out of the gravitational field and is losing energy, which is why eventually we see everything being black. Now, as a little experiment, a little thought experiment, we're basically going to travel to a black hole and we're going to basically pick the dumbest member of our crew and put him in a suit and send him in towards the black hole, right? But we still kind of care about him because he's still a member of the crew. So we're going to fit his suit with something that basically emits a beam of a flash of light every second, just so we know where he is. So he doesn't really want to go. So he doesn't want to look see what's behind him. He's just looking to see where the ship is. But he can see the flashes of light heading off towards the ship. And by his watch, he basically times 1 second between every flash of light. So he gets a little bit further away, but he's still quite good because everything is still going off at 1 second. At a certain point, he realizes, I must have crossed the event horizon because everything is now looking really, really weird around me. I can't really make out the distant stars or constellations. I have these gravitational arcs of galaxies and stuff like that. But the one thing that's constant is that according to my clock, I'm still sending out a pulse at once every second. Things look a little bit different to the person on the outside. So far away from the black hole, we see the light pulses arriving, one pulse every second. And here's where we introduce our space-time diagram. So far from the black hole, my light rays still travel out at 45 degrees. As he gets a little bit closer, I notice two things. First of all, I notice that he's not as bright as he should be considering the distance he's traveled, and also that the pulses are no longer arriving at 1 second intervals, that the distance or the time between pulses seems to be increasing. In the space-time diagram, we would basically say that because space is now being curved, the outward light rays are no longer traveling at 45 degrees, which is why he's looking dimmer, because even the light coming from his suit is not being kind of reflected properly. And at a certain point, we basically see that the time between pulses has increased so much that we're now waiting for maybe days or months for the next pulse to arrive. And that final pulse never ever arrives. This is because he's basically crossed the event horizon and now his outward light beams, the ones that are traveling towards us, are now trapped inside the event horizon because the speed at the event horizon is the speed of light. So we'd like to know what's going on. He'd like to tell us what's going on, but unfortunately, he's going through a process called spaghettification. He is literally being turned into spaghetti because the closer he gets to the singularity, the greater the difference between the gravitational force on his feet and the gravitational force on his head. So basically, while his upper body still looks okay, he basically sees his knees being ripped off from the rest of his body and basically traveling spaghetti-like down towards the center of the black hole, where his ultimate kind of existence will be quashed out. So before we go on to the formation of supermassive black holes, here's where the problem comes in. Everything I've done so far and everything I've talked about basically works in classical physics. General relativity, Maxwell's equations, the theories of relativity are all classical theories because they don't incorporate quantum mechanics. So when we talk of a singularity, we talk about a point of infinite temperature and infinite density, because that's basically what the equations tell us. Now, if you basically go back to the original singularity at the beginning of the, or at the Big Bang, we always say the same thing. It's a point of infinite temperature and infinite density, because that's what the classical equations tell us. But we know that once you go to a certain level of smallness, you need to start using quantum mechanics. And because we don't have a quantum mechanical theory of gravity, we can't actually describe the singularity. So asking questions like, what is the singularity? What's at the singularity? What happens to time or space at the singularity? The answer is, we don't know, because it's a quantum effect and we don't have a quantum theory of gravity. So in the last maybe 10 minutes, 15? Okay. I'm basically going to move on to the formation of what are called supermassive black holes, and this will lead into gravitational waves. So as we saw this morning, we can measure, and yesterday, we can measure something called a redshift, right? And because astronomers basically work in different fields, some people kind of measure distances in light years, some people measure distances in parsecs, some in gigaparsecs, and some, when you're talking about kind of going back towards the earliest times of the universe, you have to basically talk about redshift, because the number of powers in the exponent in terms of light years or meters just gets out of hand. So if you're doing galactic physics or extragalactic physics, you would basically talk about a redshift in terms of an emitted and a detected wavelength or frequency of light or something like that. When you're looking at the expansion of the universe, you basically look at how the universe is expanding due to something called the scale factor, right? And basically, this is where we are now. So this is roughly 14 billion years at a redshift of zero. You can see that it's nonlinear, so at redshift of about 25, I'm already talking about something which is about a tenth of a giga year, okay? And these are the kind of things that we actually want to see and want to look at, because if I go to kind of like a cosmic distance scale, we have the Big Bang back here, we have the microwave background being emitted here, and then we have something called the cosmic dark ages, where basically light was obscured by the particle. So every time it tried to move in a straight line, it bounced off something and it wasn't kind of escaping. And it was only at a certain point called reionization that the atoms had sufficiently formed and things had moved apart sufficiently that light was able to come on a free path. And then we were able to see stuff. But we think that the first stars started to form down around here, right? And these are the so-called population 3 stars. We think that the first galaxies started to form from a redshift of around 20 onwards. So kind of roughly about 13.4 billion years ago. And as of today, the most distant object that we know about is this object here, which I'm not going to kind of go into its name, at a redshift of about 10.7, which means that this thing formed about 420 million years after the beginning of the universe. The most distant gamma ray burst that we know about is at a redshift of about 9.4. Now, we think gamma ray bursts are when you have a binary of neutron stars that basically merge, and during the merger process, they emit a huge flux of gamma rays. And we see these things at cosmological distances. And like I said, the furthest thing we've seen is something that was basically happening about 520 million years after the creation of the universe. And the most distant quasar is at a redshift of about 7.8. And here's where we have a problem with using electromagnetic telescopes. It gets to a point whereby we can't penetrate as much as we'd like to into the cosmic dark ages. So how do we form these massive, massive black holes? Every galaxy that we look at, we're pretty much sure that at the center, there's something which we think is a black hole, except that we think it's anywhere between hundreds of thousands to hundreds of million times the mass of our own sun. Now, the question is, how do you form things this big? So there's two hypotheses. The first one is you start off with population 3 stars. These are massive hot blue stars with masses of many tens or many hundreds of solar masses. As Chiara showed yesterday, the bigger the star, the shorter its lifespan. So we expect these things to burn through in roughly 1 million years or shorter than 1 million years, producing all the heavy elements that we see today, exploding as supernova and basically giving us things like gold and uranium, plutonium, and all the major heavy elements. So these form way out in the cosmic distance, but as of yet, we have no proof for the existence of population 3 stars. Other than we have heavy elements, okay? The other option is that when the first galaxies started to form, a black hole formed in the center, but basically because the mass of the black hole was so big compared to the mass of the rest of the galaxy, that rather than forming a disk or spiral arms or anything like that, that the rest of the galaxy just basically imploded on itself and was swallowed up by the black hole. In this case, you can basically start off with black holes on the order of about 1,000 solar masses. And as we saw yesterday, we know that there are galaxy collisions and galaxy mergers. And basically the way we think things happen is we think that the massive black holes or the supermassive black holes we see today formed in a hierarchical manner. So in the past, universe was smaller, collisions were a lot more kind of common. And basically through these collisions, the small black holes back then all built up along cosmic time to give us the massive black holes we see today. So now I'm going to move on to gravitational waves, and can I get the lights turned down? Yes, sorry. Yes.
It doesn't mean that they are actually at that speed.
But we have to measure it from somebody's point of view, right? Yeah. So for example, if I measure the distance to the nearest star or nearest star system, basically the Alpha Centauri system is about 4.3 light years from us. Meaning that from our point of view here on Earth, any light emitted by the stars in the Centauri system take 4.3 years to get to us, assuming that there's very little diffraction or diffusion of light on its way to us, right? But now, if I can build a spaceship that can travel at 99.5% speed of light, and I basically send my astronaut to the Centauri system, like I said earlier, that gamma factor is about 14. So his perception of the distance between Earth and Alpha Centauri is 14 times shorter than what we think it is, so about 0.3 of a light year. So at his speed, it takes about 0.4 years to get from here to the Centauri system, which basically means that his outward and backward journey takes roughly a year of his time. But if you look at how much time has passed on Earth, 14 years have passed on Earth. So this is, again, why even time and distance, it's a difficult question, because it all depends on your observational position in the universe. So when we measure the distance to a galaxy or the velocity of a galaxy, we have to measure it with respect to a particular coordinate frame, which we take to be the Earth. But you're absolutely correct that for somebody moving at a different speed or at a different position, they may see something different. They may measure something different.
So basically, even let's say the size of the Andromeda galaxy, it doesn't mean that we calculated it's this amount of this large, but in reality it could be larger, smaller.
Well, imagine kind of an advanced civilization who are basically buzzing through the local group at 95 or 99.5% the speed of light, they would see the Andromeda galaxy to be 14 times smaller than we measure it. because as far as they're concerned, in their ship, they're all kind of stationary. They're all looking out the window as things go by, space tourists, and they see Andromeda whiz past at 99.5% the speed of light, looking squashed in one direction, right? So for them, Andromeda would be 14 times smaller than what we measure it to be. But everything that we measure, we're depending on our point of view in the universe. So that's why when we give distances and angular scales and stuff, it's all with respect to not actually us. We actually measure with kind of like with respect to the ecliptic plane, so the center of the solar system or something like that. Okay. So I think you can...
No, I just wanted to say that the meaning of relativity is that you can say in reality, because what is the reality? It depends on the framework.
Yeah.
So when you say in reality, distance can be bigger or whatever, what does it mean reality? What is the reality?
Yeah, so this comes back to the question a while ago of... Yes.
If you're willing to put down all four coordinates, space and time, of this event and another event, the distance between that is invariant to all of your universal frames. There is a way you can uniquely specify that, but you have to use all four coordinates.
Yes.
If you're insisting on measuring the length or just the time, you get a different answer.
Yes. Which again comes back to the question of, if you ask somebody what happened before the Big Bang, or concept of space-time only started at the Big Bang, right? We have no universal direction of time, or we have no universal time itself. So as far as we're concerned, the position of the Big Bang in space-time, if you want to take it as a point of reference, is 0000. You have to measure all four, or you have to specify all four coordinates, okay? Which is always why there's a question. It's confusing to people, and sometimes it's confusing to us scientists as well, when people measure what they call the curvature of the universe. It's confusing on whether they're measuring the curvature of space or trying to measure the curvature of space-time. So it's, as George said, you have to be very, very careful how you postulate the question in the first place. Because it's always very different on whether you're talking about space and time or space-time. Okay. Yeah. So, gravitational waves. As Jim pointed out this morning, some of the results that he had were less than a year old, and as George pointed out yesterday, some of the results we've been getting in terms of the microwave background are accelerating very, very quickly. For example, in March, an experiment says that they found primordial black holes, and the day before we actually came here, another experiment called that into question. So things happen at a very, very, very rapid pace these days in science. So we're on the verge of what I think is the next great leap in science and scientific experiment and discovery, and these are things called gravitational waves. So I've already showed you that things like curvature of light, the delay of radio signals, the precession of the perihelion of Mercury are all more than adequately explained by the predictions of general relativity. But one of the last, or probably the last untested prediction of general relativity are these quantities called gravitational waves. And basically, Einstein postulated that if you can get something massive enough to move fast enough, it would actually cause ripples in space-time itself, which would basically propagate out from the source. And in the same way as a boat bobs up and down on the sea as waves pass underneath it, so too would all the planets and the galaxies and every bit of dust and whatever that sits on space-time. So there are some comparisons, some similarities with electromagnetic waves. So like I said earlier, if you go from a purely quantum mechanical point of view, then a photon is an oscillation of the electromagnetic field, whereas the gravitational wave is an oscillation of the gravitational field. And they both obey an inverse square law. They both have the velocity of light as their speed of propagation, and they both have two polarizations. But the difference now starts where we know that light has polarizations rotated by 90 degrees. The gravitational waves have polarizations which are rotated by 45 degrees. We know that light is readily scattered and diffracted by interactions with matter. And we know that other particles, even kind of neutrinos, which are considered to be ghostly, have interactions with matter. Gravitational waves have virtually no interaction with matter because, once again, you have to remember that the matter is sitting on top of the gravitational field, and this is an oscillation of that field. So it's not really interacting with the matter that sat on top of it. And like I said, one's an oscillation of the electromagnetic field and one's an oscillation of space-time. So imagine I have two rings of particles sat in space, and Einstein never came along, there was no prediction of gravitational waves, then as long as these two rings of particles are far away from a gravitational wave or from a gravitational source, they'll just sit there forever, unperturbed, in a ring. What we expect to happen with gravitational waves is, imagine you have a plane wave coming out of the board. As it passes through the two rings of particles, you get this oscillation. These are the two polarizations. So you have what we call a plus, because it's first of all stretched in this direction and then in this direction, and a cross polarization because you get the stretching in this direction here. So why do we want to use gravitational waves? So our best telescopes at the moment will basically take us on a journey where we can basically focus in on various galaxies. What we're interested in is what is at the center of each galaxy, because first of all, we want to kind of prove that there are supermassive black holes. And secondly, we want to actually work out what their masses are, what their spins are, and stuff like that. But unfortunately, you can see that as I get towards the center of the galaxy, I now have all the stars and dust and whatever at the central part of the galaxy, which is much brighter than anywhere else, and even my best optical telescopes can't really get in there. The second problem is that, as we saw yesterday, if you have galaxies, you can also have what are called active galaxies, which emit a jet, usually in the radio or something like that. So you have these huge lobes extending many millions of light years out from the center. And that's fine because you can basically detect these things using radio telescopes. From the size and the width of the jet and stuff like that, you can make an estimation of what the central black hole mass is, but the errors are very, very big. And then you have the problem that depending on which way the jet is rotated towards us, you may not even see the structure of the galaxy itself. So what is maybe realistically a spiral galaxy looks slightly elliptical or barred or whatever, and it can even be that we're looking straight down the center of a beam. In which case, this is what we see, essentially a point source in the sky. So what we'd like to do is to somehow then get beyond this, right? And basically travel into the center of the galaxies where we think that there's a supermassive black hole. The supermassive black hole pulls gas into an accretion disk. And basically, as this gas gets pulled in, it starts to rotate towards the center of the black hole, it gets heated up, and you get emission and things like X-rays. So if you have an X-ray telescope, you can now do better than your optical telescope, but you're still limited by the resolution of your X-rays. What we'd like to do now, once more, is to actually see what this point right here in the center actually is. And like I said, estimate its masses and stuff like that. So this starts off as a simulation of a galaxy collision, but you can see that once the two galaxies become gravitationally bound, the two centers start to orbit around each other. And if we assume that there's two massive black holes at the center of each galaxy, at a certain point, they become gravitationally bound in this newly formed galaxy, and they start to lose energy and orbit in towards each other. At a certain point, the interaction with the background field stars basically lessens, and it's now just pure gravitational coupling between the two objects. at this point, they're actually emitting gravitational waves and losing energy in. And when they coalesce, you get these outward ripples, which are what we call the gravitational waves. Now, this is kind of one of the best numerical simulations that we have to date, which basically shows the orbit of two black holes. I wouldn't worry about these kind of white and yellow lines here. They're more mathematical constructs than anything else, just to show how the grid is forming. So if we start the simulation, the two black holes are orbiting around each other. They're getting closer because they're losing energy due to gravitational waves. And basically, if we zoom out, we can basically see, and I hope you can see in the red, we can basically see the emission of gravitational waves. And as the two objects get closer and closer, the intensity and the color of the gravitational waves change until we're left with a single merged black hole back at the center. So we have a bunch of gravitational wave sources. We have binaries of white dwarfs, neutron stars, and black holes. We estimate that the beginning of the universe should have created gravitational waves, which is what we thought BICEP had detected. We don't kind of believe that the things were perfectly harmonious at the beginning of the universe. There might have been defects, which we call cosmic strings and stuff like that. If you have an isolated neutron star and it has basically an asymmetry, like a mountain or a valley or something, that will emit gravitational waves. And also the violence of a supernova will also give out gravitational waves. Now, binary systems are our main target because our sun is very, very particular, because the vast majority of stars in the solar system, or sorry, in the Milky Way, are actually in binary and tertiary systems. It's very, very strange, like we are, to find a single star. And in fact, as George pointed out yesterday, people have hypothesized that we have a secondary companion, which is really, really low mass and very, very kind of distant from us, and which passes every now and again to influence things. So binary system evolution is completely different to an isolated star, because first of all, the second object, if it's a compact object like a neutron star or a black hole or a white dwarf, can actually pull material off the main sequence star, which basically accelerates the evolution and changes the evolution of that star completely. And also, when you have a supernova of one object, it can basically destroy the entire system if it wants to, or if it can. So we actually have indirect evidence for the emission of gravitational waves. A Nobel Prize was given to Hulse and Taylor for the observation of a binary pulsar. And basically what they measured over a period of about 30 years was how much the orbit was decaying. And the prediction of general relativity is this straight line here, which basically says that if gravitational waves are being emitted because these two compact objects are getting closer and closer together, that the change of period should basically fall off like this. And the observations fit the prediction from general relativity almost perfectly. So that's our indirect proof that gravitational waves actually exist. Now, we have a bunch of other systems where we now have measured the same thing. And more recently, we found the most relativistic system yet, where the change of period in the last 2.5 years has actually been more than we've measured with the Hulse-Taylor binary in the last 30. It's the most relativistic system known yet. So how do we measure them? Well, we use laser interferometers. So we basically send out some light here, we split it in two, we send it to a mirror, which is maybe many kilometers away in this direction. When they combine back here, they basically should create an interference pattern. What we do is we put a photodiode on the dark fringe. If the gravitational wave passes, like we saw with the free particles in space, then the mirrors should start to move in and out, which is basically showing the deformation of space-time upon which the mirrors are actually resting. And if that happens, then the photodiode should basically start picking up light that it wouldn't normally pick up. At the moment, we have a bunch of detectors, both actual and planned, on the ground. In the States, we have two detectors, LIGO 1 in Hanford and LIGO 2 in Louisiana. Just outside Pisa, we have a Franco-Italian project called Virgo. In Germany, outside Garching, there's a 600-meter telescope. And there's basically planned telescopes for the future. There's a European project called the Einstein Telescope, which will have 10-kilometer long tunnels and which will be situated many hundreds of meters below the Earth. The Japanese are looking at building a subterranean cryogenically cooled detector. And there was plans to put one of the LIGO detectors in Australia so that we actually can carry out triangulation. But it looks like now it's probably going to go to India instead. So because the frequency of the gravitational waves is inversely proportional to the mass, then we can only detect things like neutron stars and stellar mass black holes using the ground-based detectors. On top of that, the tectonic plates move with a frequency of between 1 and 10 hertz. And these things are so sensitive that even a plane passing overhead or a storm cloud can change the gravitational potential so much that at a certain point, it's impossible to tell the difference between that and a gravitational wave signal. So at frequencies greater than, say, 1 to 10 hertz, we can only detect objects that are roughly around the same size as the sun. To basically measure and detect the supermassive black holes we were talking about, we need to put a detector in space. And next year, ESA is flying a technology demonstration mission called LISA Pathfinder, which will basically launch in July, which will test the technology for a future detector in space, which will look for these supermassive black holes. And basically, this observatory will be composed of three satellites separated by a million kilometers. We'll basically fire lasers the million kilometers between the satellites and basically measure the phases of the lasers as they arrive at the different points. Again, if a gravitational wave is passed through, then the distance between the satellites changes in a rhythmic manner, and we expect to detect about 4,000 sources a year out to a redshift of Z equals 10. This may allow us to actually investigate the original seeds of massive black holes as well, and possibly allow us to see into the dark ages where we can test the hypothesis of population 3 stars. So this is my last slide. So why are they so important? A lot of the time when we estimate distances with electromagnetic telescopes, we have an error of between, say, 30 and 70%. When we try and estimate the mass of a central object, we maybe try and use the motions of the stars around the objects like we do to measure the mass at the black hole at the center of the Milky Way. Or we look at the X-ray luminosity and try and measure the speed of the accretion disk. But sometimes this can basically give us errors in the estimate of masses that are actually greater than 100%, which means we can't really say anything about them. And as we saw this morning, one of the best ways to estimate distances is to use supernovae. Now, when a supernova explodes, it emits about 10 to the 40 watts of energy, or in terms of photons, that means that for a particular amount of time, it's 10 to the 14 times brighter than the sun in the daytime sky. The merger of two supermassive black holes in gravitational waves, not photons, will basically be brighter than 10 to the 26 times the brightness of the sun, which makes these phenomenal objects and possibly the most violent objects in the universe. And because the polarizations are proportional to 1/1 the distance, we hope that with a lot of the objects we detect, that we can basically constrict the error in the distance to less than 10%. And what's most remarkable is that we should be able to measure the masses of these supermassive black holes to less than 0.01%. This means that if we're getting many tens or hundreds of objects a year, we can build up a picture back into the distant universe of how these massive black holes formed and hopefully answer, were they from population 3 stars? Were they from protogalactic collapse? Or is nature actually some kind of mixture of the two of them? So this is going to be a very, very exciting field, which will open up in the next maybe 20 to 25 years. And that is my last slide, so thank you very much. Thank you.